Don't forget to subscribe and turn the notifications. We upload daily, and check the source of this video to view all the images and videos if there was any. Theresa May is facing fresh turmoil today after two of her party vice chairs quit in protest at her Brexit plans, warning they will lead to Prime Minister Corbyn. Brexiteers Ben Bradley and Maria Caulfield handed in their resignations just a day after Boris Johnson's dramatic departure. Their coordinated departures are designed to inflict maximum damage on the PM, who is battling for her political survival. And it comes just hours after Ms. Caulfield complained Brexiteers have overnight been turned into the enemy in a leaked WhatsApp message. Meanwhile, the first letters of no confidence in Mrs. May have been sent in today as the Tory party descends into open warfare over its Brexit policy. Andrew Bridgen has handed in his letter to Sir Graham Brady, chairman of the 1922 committee, the group of backbench Tory MPs, piling further pressure on the PM. Mrs. May is battling for her political survival after a string of Brexiteers, including her Brexit chief David Davis, sensationally quit over the past 48 hours, throwing her government and departure plans into disarray. If 48 letters are sent in, then a leadership contest is will be triggered, but the PM has vowed to stay, face down her critics and fight to stay in number 10. Ben Bradley, pictured left, and Maria Caulfield, pictured right with David Cameron, both handed in the resignations in letters in which they tore into her proposals for a third way. Their coordinated departures are designed to inflict maximum damage on the PM, pictured today with Angela Merkel at a summit in London, who is battling for her political survival. Mr. Bradley, who was made Tory vice chairman for young people in the reshuffle in January, said he voted Remain but now backs Brexit because of the immense opportunities of global trade. Brexiteer erupt in blue-on-blue anger in leaked WhatsApp messages. Tory MPs in the European Research Group, the powerful collection of backbench Brexiteer conservatives, have swapped angry messages attacking number 10 and their Tory colleagues. Leaked to Guido Fawkes. Here are some of them. Lawrence Robertson: tomorrow is going to be difficult. HTE sycophants and careerists will rally round the PM and her position, whereas the rest of us will be fighting for the future of our country. Those will be the battle lines. Maria Caulfield, reflecting on yesterday: the most hurtful bit has been the way those of us who support Leave have overnight been turned into the enemy. We have never once voted against the government on this. We are not calling for a leadership challenge, in fact the opposite, and have been constructive and flexible in our approach. But it would be disloyal to say all is well when, if you poke your nose outside the door, it clearly isn't. I will always be honest and say what I think, even if it is not popular. What I can't stand is people saying one thing to your face and another behind your back. I hope the PM is able to see that not all of those cheering her on yesterday have her and the country's best interests at heart. Philip Davies: unfortunately, whatever lies, aka spin, Downing Street might want to tell, the statement issued is therefore at all to see, and that makes clear that all the red lines have been breached, including even on immigration. I appreciate they think all Brexiteers are thick and they are very clever, but we are not quite as stupid as they would like to believe. Andrew Bridgen, who has put in a letter of no confidence in the PM for the first time ever: I really don't want to go to Parliament on Monday. In his resignation letter he said, I fear that this agreement at Chequers damages those opportunities, that being tied to EU regulation, and the EU tying our hands when seeking to make new trade arrangements, will be the worst of all worlds if we do not deliver Brexit in spirit as well as in name. Then we are handing Jeremy Corbyn the keys to number 10. Mr. Bradley stuck the knife into the PM even though Downing Street stood by him when earlier this year he was exposed for posting offensive messages. In one post he suggested men on benefits should get a vasectomy and stop relying on the welfare state to support their children. Ms. Caulfield, who was made a party vice chairman for women in the January reshuffle, is an ardent Brexiteer. But she warned in her resignation letter, she said she cannot support the PM's Brexit plans because, in my view, they do not fully embrace the opportunities Brexit can provide. She added, the policy may assuage vested interests, but the voters will find out and their representatives will be found out. This policy will be bad for our country now, bad for the party. The direct consequences of that will be Prime Minister Corbyn. She used a WhatsApp thread for members of the European Research Group, the powerful alliance of backbench Brexit-backing conservatives, to complain about the way they have been treated. She said, reflecting on yesterday, the most hurtful bit has been the way those of us who support Leave have overnight been turned into the enemy. We have never once voted against the government on this. We are not calling for a leadership challenge, in fact the opposite, and have been constructive and flexible in our approach. But it would be disloyal to say all is well when if you poke your nose outside the door, it clearly isn't. I will always be honest and say what I think even if it is not popular. What I can't stand is people saying one thing to your face and another behind your back. I hope the PM is able to see that not all of those cheering her on yesterday have her and the country's best interests at heart. Meanwhile, Tory MPs have publicly attacked each other in expletive-ridden tirades online as the party starts tearing itself apart. The resignation of Chris Green as a ministerial bag carrier last night prompted Simon Hart to blast "Nobody gives a f asterisk asterisk asterisk" at his party colleague. West and South Pembrokeshire MP Mr. Hart also lashed out at Brexiteer Tory Andrea Jenkins for celebrating the resignation of Boris Johnson yesterday afternoon. He insisted, "This is not a game," at the Morley and Outward MP, prompting Simon Hall to pile in as well. Mr. Hall fired off at Ms. Jenkins, "Could someone, anyone remove Ms. Jenkins' access to Twitter? We are drowning in vacuity. We are dealing with the future of our country, not some mystic Meg predictions." Meanwhile, Brexiteer Tory MPs in the European Research Group, the backbench group of Leaver MPs, are turning on each other in their private WhatsApp group chat as they divided into two camps, those who back the PM's third way deal and those who have slammed it. Maria Caulfield, who was made a party vice chairman for women in the January reshuffle, is an ardent Brexiteer. Ben Bradley, who was made Tory vice chairman for young people in the reshuffle in January, said he voted Remain but now backs Brexit because of the immense opportunities of global trade. Simon Hart was the first to lay into Ms. Jenkins' celebration of Boris Johnson's resignation by warning the Morley and Outward MP the Brexit chaos was not a game. The warning prompted Simon Hall to wade into the row to demand Ms. Jenkins be stopped from tweeting because the party was drowning in vacuity. In a separate Twitter row last night, Mr. Hart lashed out at Tory Chris Green for announcing his resignation as a ministerial bag carrier. Tory Simon Hall, left, and Simon Hart, right, have lashed out at Brexiteer colleagues on Twitter. Theresa May tweeted a picture of her new look cabinet team today saying they had a productive meeting. Tory MP Lawrence Robertson branded those rallying around the PM sycophants and careerists, while Philip Davies MP accused number 10 of lying about the plan. In a seething WhatsApp message leaded to Guido Fawkes, he wrote, "Unfortunately, whatever lies, aka spin, Downing Street might want to tell, the statement issued is there for us all to see, and that makes clear that all the red lines have been breached, including even on immigration. I appreciate they think all Brexiteers are thick and they are very clever, but we are not quite as stupid as they would like to believe." Andrew Bridgen MP, who has put in a letter of no confidence in the PM, wrote, "For the first time ever, I really don't want to go to Parliament on Monday. How could Theresa May be ousted as Tory leader? Theresa May faces a mortal threat to her leadership of the Conservative Party and government. A Tory leadership contest can be called in one of two ways, if Mrs. May resigns or if MPs force and win a vote of no confidence in her. Calling votes of no confidence is the responsibility of the chairman of the 1922 committee, which includes all backbench Tory MPs. Chairman Graham Brady is obliged to call a vote if 15% of Tory MPs write to him calling for one, currently 48 MPs. The process is secret and only Mr. Brady knows how many letters he has received. The procedure was last used in 2003 when Ian Duncan Smith was ousted as Tory leader. If Mrs. May is ousted, any MP is eligible to stand. Conservative MPs will then hold a series of ballots to whittle the list of contenders down to two, with the last place candidate dropping out in each round. The final two candidates are then offered to the Tory membership at large for an election." The angry exchanges came as Theresa May fought to draw a line under 24 hours of extraordinary drama that saw David Davis and Boris Johnson both quit cabinet. The ailing PM hailed her new-look cabinet today as she staggers from two bombshell resignations in the space of 24 hours. The Prime Minister praised the productive first meeting with her reshaped team as she tries to draw a line under the shattering departures of her Brexit secretary and foreign secretary in protest at her weak Brexit trade plans. Mrs. May scrambled to fill the holes in cabinet last night with a series of radical moves, shifting Jeremy Hunt to Foreign Secretary and Dominic Raab into the key Brexit Secretary role. Matt Hancock has been promoted from the Culture Department to Health Secretary as the Premier digs in for an attritional battle with Eurosceptics. Tweeting a picture of the cabinet meeting, Mrs. May said, "Productive cabinet meeting this morning, looking ahead to a busy week. and sending our best wishes to it England for tomorrow. In a boost for Mrs. May, it emerged last night that the chair of the powerful Tory 1922 committee has yet to receive the 48 letters from MPs needed to trigger a no-confidence vote. But although she has weathered the initial shock of the resignations, furious Brexiteers have warned that a challenge could come within weeks unless she changes policy. There is also anger that politicians who campaigned for Remain in the referendum are now installed in the four great offices of state, with Mrs. May as PM, Philip Hammond Chancellor, Jeremy Hunt Foreign Secretary, and Sajid Javid Home Secretary. Justice Secretary David Gorky insisted the cabinet was now fully behind Mrs. May's approach on Brexit after the departures. Clearly David and Boris have reached their conclusions that they couldn't support the policy. I think it is right the cabinet backs the Prime Minister and speaks with one voice, and if people don't do that then clearly the honourable thing to do is go, he told BBC Radio 4's Today programme. Ben Bradley's resignation letter in full: I fully understand and appreciate the great many challenges you face in delivering on Brexit, not least the balancing act in the House of Commons that constrains your freedom. However, I have come to the conclusion that I cannot in good faith be a spokesman for the party or for government on this issue, and I cannot with any sincerity defend this course to my electorate, 71% of whom vote to leave the European Union. There has been much discussion over the last 2 years since the referendum about the motives of Leave voters. I admit that I voted to remain in the ballot. What has swayed me over the last 2 years to fully back the Brexit vision is the immense opportunities that are available from global trade, and for the ability for Britain to be an outward-looking nation in control of our own destiny once again. I fear that this agreement it checkers damages those opportunities, that being tied to EU regulation, and the EU tying our hands when seeking to make new trade arrangements, will be the worst of all worlds if we do not deliver Brexit in spirit as well as in name of. Then we are handing Jeremy Corbyn the keys to number 10. In my view, this problem stems from the decision to accept the backstop agreements for Northern Ireland. I understand why you perhaps felt that you had to take that decision at that time, but it now becomes the barrier to the kind of free-ranging free trade agreement with the EU that many in our party and the country would like to see. It has become a problem rather than a solution, but the Northern Ireland backstop cannot be allowed to become the deciding factor for the whole of the UK's economy and trade policies. We must hold out for a deal that is right for our country, and ensure that walking away on WTO terms is a genuine and achievable alternative should that prove impossible. As the MP for Mansfield, I believe that the almost three-quarters of local people who voted Leave did so wanting to give Britain control of its own destiny, its borders and its laws. I owe it to my constituents to raise my conscience and speak freely about this policy, and to fulfil the promise I made to them in the 2017 election to make Mansfield's voice heard for the first time in decades. I have taken this decision with great regret, as I have very much enjoyed my work at CCHQ, rebuilding a new organisation to reach out to young Conservative members around the country. I am certain that I leave this work in a far better place than when I arrived in January, and I trust that these strides forward will continue under Brandon Lewis' excellent leadership. I thank you for giving me the opportunity to take on the role, and for the support that has been given to me throughout my time as Vice Chairman. I was elected last year on the back of a campaign that focused on your leadership, and on delivering Brexit. I hope that under your continued leadership we can make the necessary changes to these proposals and fulfill the promise we made to the electorate. Yours, Ben Bradley MP.